Welcome to this episode of the 1600 Sessions. Today, it's my privilege to have a conversation with Karen Tumulty, the author of the extraordinary new biography on Nancy Reagan. Karen was with the Time magazine for a long time of her career and has been with the Washington Post as a political writer and is a really highly regarded and respected journalist here in Washington, D.C. She's undertaken a major work with a biography of Nancy Reagan, and I had the privilege of beginning my career working in the Reagan administration and worked on the Reagan Centennial, and it was a treasure trove of learning for me. I learned so much from this book, and I know that those of you who have read it agree, and those of you who have not read it, order it before you go to bed tonight. You'll really enjoy reading it. Well, let's dive in, Karen, and talk about your wonderful book. Why Nancy Reagan? How did you come to focus on her as a subject of a biography?
Well, first of all, let me say how delighted I am to be here in this lovely setting and seeing the controversial Reagan China for the first time. So I guess there's two ways to look at this question. Why a book on Nancy Reagan? And that's pretty simple. Simon & Schuster, it was a few months after Mrs. Reagan died, came to me and said, we want a biography of her. Do you want to write it? And I never written a book before. I wasn't really sure I could write a book.
Oh,
and
really?
I thought, well, this sounds intriguing. But why this book? It really took me, I worked on this book for 4.5 years, and I was at least 2 years into the research before really all the pieces of this very, very complex woman began to sort of fit together for me. And I began to realize that if I could pull this book off the way I wanted to, the story of Nancy Reagan would also become the story of the rise of one of the most consequential figures of the 20th century, really a story about the shaping of the Reagan presidency, and in fact, also of the shaping of the Reagan legacy. And that is why I have been so gratified by the extraordinary critical review that this book has received, because it really is much, much bigger, I think, than what I set out to do, which was a story, a biography of a woman and a marriage, and of course, an epic love story. Nancy Reagan had a real impact on her husband, his legacy, and his presidency, and not just as we often hear about first ladies, oh, she was his closest advisor. I mean, she had a true impact on some of his biggest successes, some of his most important policies.
What were some of the challenges that you encountered in writing this book that you didn't anticipate?
Again, just how many layers there were to this woman who was one of our most controversial of first ladies, certainly of our modern first ladies. And also the degree to which she herself, because she kind of molded herself as a very traditional first lady, she was anything but, how much of herself she had sort of kept hidden and really made sure wasn't understood in her lifetime.
Well, you obviously came to know her very well through the course of writing this book. If after writing the book you could sit down with her and interview her, what would you ask her? What would you want to know from her?
The conundrum to me for Nancy Reagan is that Ronald Reagan was a very solitary figure. She had a far superior sense than he does. I mean, people like James Baker, who was their first White House chief of staff, would tell you she had a much better nose for trouble, a much better sense of who around him was serving him well and who was pursuing their own interests, you know, who had not lived up to his trust and therefore who needed to go. Often she made them disappear. So I would want to know how she could possibly be so shrewd about what was in her husband's interest and so clueless so often about her own image.
If Nancy Reagan could convene a table for dinner of other first ladies, who do you think she would find most interesting? Who would she want to know more about?
I think she would definitely want to have Jackie Kennedy there, who, was, the word icon is overused so much, but of course, you know, Jackie Kennedy set such a style in the White House in ways that Nancy Reagan tried to emulate disastrously with refurbishing the White House and buying expensive china. So she would definitely want Jackie Kennedy there. She would definitely want Eleanor Roosevelt there because in some ways, Eleanor Roosevelt was her husband's eyes and ears, and in his case, his legs. The way, in some ways, the role that Nancy Reagan performed, people will not believe that comparison, but also because Franklin Roosevelt was Ronald Reagan's most admired president. She actually read biographies of other first ladies. And I know that she was also very interested in Theodore Roosevelt's wife and how she performed as first lady.
Well, that would be, you know, I've often thought about that too. And you think about, you mentioning Jackie Kennedy, and here's a woman who was 32 years old when her husband was elected president. She was first lady for less than 3 years, but has left such an extraordinary legacy, including the creation of the White House Historical Association. And Nancy Reagan, much more senior in her life, a two-term president, and so quite a different role as first lady. So it'd be interesting to compare those or see those two. I'd love to be a fly on the wall for that conversation.
Well, there was one point where, in the first year of the Reagan presidency, where Nancy Reagan is in one controversy after another, redoing the White House, buying china, borrowing designer clothes. I mean, she can't turn around without creating a new controversy. And in the middle of this, she gets a letter from Jackie Kennedy saying, "You are going to get through this." And then she says, "But in the meantime, you may not want to look at the newspapers."
That's good advice. Maybe not for your business, right. But that's good advice. Well, I did have the privilege of working on the Reagan Centennial, that year-long observance of his 100th birthday in 2011. And one of the things that we undertook in that process was to consider what made the man. Was it his Midwestern upbringing? Was it the roles he held in California with the labor union as governor? Was it the influences on his life, his mother, Mrs. Reagan? What about Nancy Reagan? What made her the person that she became and equipped her to be a first lady? And do you think Ronald Reagan would have been as politically successful or even been president without her?
Well, I'll take that last question first. People who were closest to the Reagans tell me no. Stewart Spencer, Ronald Reagan's first political consultant, his advisor throughout his career, says he would never have been governor without her. He would never have been president without her. She, as I said, had this incredibly keen radar and protectiveness that I do think a figure such as Ronald Reagan, who was a perpetual optimist, a delegator, somebody who didn't sweat the details. I mean, he needed a worrier, and he was close to exactly one human being in the world, and he married her. But when you look at Nancy Reagan, she comes from a very traumatic childhood that she never really liked to talk about all that much. Her mother was an ambitious actress. Her biological father was an unsuccessful car salesman. The marriage is essentially over when this inconveniently timed baby arrives. And as soon as the little girl at that point named Anne Frances Robbins is out of diapers, her mother essentially abandons her for 6 years with relatives. So this child's earliest memories are yearning for her absent mother, as her mother, an actress, goes and pursues her career and her social life. And that leaves her with, as their son Ron explained to me, a sort of wariness, a fear of abandonment that never really lifts, and certainly seems to be confirmed 2 months into her husband's presidency, where she almost loses him to, you know, the seemingly random event that a would-be assassin gets close enough to shoot him. So her mother, though, ultimately comes back and in 1929 arrives in Bethesda, Maryland, where she has left Nancy, and informs her that she's getting married, that they are moving to Chicago. She is marrying a neurosurgeon. Imagine a neurosurgeon in the 1920s, what a pioneer he has to have been. But it is really then Edith, her mother, who engineers their rise in Chicago society. She's, you know, Loyal Davis, her husband, Dr. Loyal Davis, Nancy adores him, but he's kind of a stern, distant figure. It is really Edith Davis who does the networking. Her friends from acting, people like Spencer Tracy, are just coming through the house all the time. And as Nancy's stepbrother told me, in his parents' marriage, Loyal and Edith Davis, where he is the, you know, he is a man of substance, but she is the one who builds the scaffolding for the rise.
Interesting.
You really see the pattern that would arise in the Reagans' marriage. And so while her mother is the source of great trauma when she is young, her mother ultimately gives her a pattern for the love partnership that could not only provide the kind of security that Nancy spends her life craving, but also for the pattern for, again, how you can make one plus one add up to so much more than two.
Wow. So you don't think Jane Wyman would have been first lady?
Right. Jane Wyman walked out of Reagan's first marriage because she essentially got bored with him. And one of the things she was most bored with, as she would testify in court in their divorce proceedings, was that her husband, the president of the Screen Actors Guild, just couldn't shut up about politics.
But yet it was the Screen Actors Guild that brought Ronald Reagan and Nancy Reagan together. Tell us that story.
Well, there is the sort of official version they like to talk about how in the fall of 1949, she's an actress, recently arrived on the MGM lot, sees her name in the Hollywood Reporter among a list of suspected communist sympathizers. This is the Red Scare. She panics. So she goes to Mervyn LeRoy, who's directing a movie she has a small part in, and she says, you know, what do I do about this? I'm not a communist. So she says, maybe the Screen Actors Guild could figure this out. So LeRoy goes to Ronald Reagan, the president of the guild, who's disappointed when he calls because he thinks LeRoy's calling to offer him a part. He quickly discovers it's another Nancy Davis they're talking about. Well, and he says, don't worry about it. Screen Actors Guild's got your back. Nancy says, no, I'm really going to have to meet him in person to really calm my fears. Well, the fact is, she'd had her eye on this.
Yes, I could see an agenda behind it.
Right. She kind of had her eye on this newly single, handsome guy for a while. But when Ronald Reagan shows up at her doorstep for this supposedly blind but carefully engineered on her part first date, he is at the lowest point of his life. His wife has walked out. His career is coming to an end. He himself has childhood trauma, having been the son of an alcoholic. He is also standing there literally a broken man. He shows up for their first date on two crutches because he's been 2 months in traction because his leg was broken in six places. And as he would later say, if Nancy Davis hadn't come along when she did, I would have lost my soul. Now, it is, no one could have imagined the future that would open up for the two of them. And certainly their love story from there wasn't entirely smooth. I mean, this guy was not quite ready to be pinned down for quite a while. But, you know, that is the opening of this kind of epic love story.
Well, reflecting back on President Reagan's life and leadership and legacy, the Reagan Library used the phrase, Ronald Reagan inspired freedom changed the world as president. Those are big themes. How much did Mrs. Reagan influence, intentionally or unintentionally, those big theme outcomes of the Reagan presidency?
So I open the book on a story that George Shultz, who was Secretary of State for most of the Reagan presidency, told me. He was 97 years old when he tells me this story. He's just fairly new in the job in 1983. He's been there 7 months. He really doesn't know the Reagans all that well. Washington gets sucked in by a blizzard. He's barely beaten the snow coming back from a trip to China. And as the city's digging out on Saturday, he gets this call from the First Lady saying, why don't you and your wife come over for dinner? It'll just be the four of us. So George Shultz goes over, and again, it's a small dinner. And all of a sudden, both of the Reagans start pounding him with questions about the Chinese. What are they like? Do they have a bottom line? And from there, Ronald Reagan starts talking about the Soviet Union and his own ideas for engaging them. And it suddenly occurs to Shultz, as he told me, this man has never had a conversation with a big-time communist leader, and he is dying to have one. And this is a revelation to Shultz, because Ronald Reagan has had decades of anti-communist rhetoric. His administration is full of hardliners who believe there could never be any such thing as a working relationship with Moscow. He's presiding over the biggest peacetime military buildup in history. So it is a revelation to Shultz that this man wants to reach out to Moscow. But then Shultz realizes in that same moment that that was the whole reason Nancy Reagan set up that dinner. That she wanted Shultz to really understand something important about her husband and something that really had the potential to change history.
With that dinner with the Shultzes, was that before or after the Evil Empire reference?
The Evil Empire, okay, one of the other things that Nancy does is she tries to sort of dial back some of her husband's rhetoric. So later that spring, he gives a speech where he refers to the Soviet Union as an evil empire. She hates that. And the Reagans were a real married couple, which means they had real arguments. So Stewart Spencer, who I mentioned earlier, their close political advisor, is also invited over to a private dinner in the residence shortly after that. And Nancy Reagan is still just pounding on Ronald Reagan about this evil empire thing. And he's trying to defend himself. And finally, he turns to Stu Spencer and he says, you know, Stu, what do you think? And Stu goes, well, Mr. President, they are an evil empire, but yeah, that was kind of harsh. At which point Reagan just doesn't want his wife to have any more ammunition and just says, what do we have for dessert?
There's a great light that shines on the president and first lady, and they're highly visible to our country. And it's obviously the office to the president and his staff, the White House, but it's also the home to the president and his family. How did Nancy Reagan, or how did the Reagans, make the residence of the White House their home? Not just aesthetically, but how did they live there in a way that nurtured their marriage, nurtured the relationship?
Well, her decision to renovate the White House, and specifically the private quarters of the White House in the middle of a recession, was politically a disaster. But she does want it to be a home. And you know, yes, they threw glittering social events, dozens and dozens of beautiful state dinners. They were out and about in Washington. But most evenings, Ronald Reagan, he would take a lot of work home with him. It would be just the two of them. They would watch the news on TV trays, and then he would, you know, go and finish his work. But he wanted nothing more than to just be home with Nancy. And if you read his diaries, it's like almost every entry is sort of suffused with references to her, like, well, Nancy's been gone for 35 hours. It feels like a barn in here.
In your book, you speak of influences on Mrs. Reagan, some conventional, some unconventional people she would talk with. You mentioned James Baker earlier. Who were some of the more unconventional influences on her thinking that were in their own way, became very controversial.
Well, the most controversial, of course, is when it is revealed in the final year of his presidency that she has been relying on an astrologer to weigh in on when the president should make a trip or give a speech or schedule, you know, all sorts of events. And this grows in part, first of all, Hollywood is kind of a superstitious place anyway. So a lot of people in Hollywood had interest in astrology going back to the 40s. But in the chapter on the assassination attempt, I really try to take the reader minute by minute by minute what that day was like for Ronald Reagan, but for Nancy Reagan, seeing her husband a lot closer to death than the White House led on at that time. When Ronald Reagan survives that, he has a religious faith. He believes that God preserved him for a reason. God has a purpose for him. That really gives him sort of a peace. And Nancy Reagan doesn't really have that kind of religious faith. In fact, her father, her adoptive father that she so worshipped, was an atheist. So she is looking for essentially anything that can give her a sense of control, because she is just racked by anxiety. She is racked by the fear that anytime her husband sets foot outside the White House, there's somebody out there waiting to finish off the job that John Hinckley started. So one day, her good friend Merv Griffin, big talk show host, entertainment executive, someone with whom she shared a July 6th birthday and an interest in astrology, says, you know, there was this woman in San Francisco, she knew March 30th was going to be a bad day. And she really, in her desperation, it's completely irrational. It's understandable on some levels, but completely irrational, turns to an astrologer, Joan Quigley, and really gives her a lot of power over, you know, whether the president is in the White House one day or not. Not over policy, though Quigley would later claim she did have that influence. And in the first term, all of this is handled by Michael Deaver, Deputy White House Chief of Staff, Nancy's closest confidant, and really kept a secret. But when Deaver leaves in the second term, other people have to be let in on the secret, one of whom is Donald Reagan, the autocratic White House Chief of Staff. He and Nancy Reagan have an epic battle during Iran-Contra. She gets him fired. He gets his revenge by writing a tell-all book that begins with this revelation that the President of the United States' schedule has been in the hands of an astrologer. It sounded almost too wacky to believe.
Well, the influence of that type of the astrologer on the scheduling aspects of the presidency, and then her influence over who was actually serving in various roles. You mentioned the Don Reagan episode.
Not the astrologer's influence,
Reagan's influence, and you mentioned the Don Reagan episode. Was Mrs. Reagan essentially a de facto chief of staff to the president?
In some ways, I think that's a good way to describe it. You know, in the first term, they had what was called the Troika. It was an ungainly situation where you had a chief of staff, James Baker, who he himself didn't know the Reagans well. He told me he got the job because Nancy wanted him to have the job. Deaver, Michael Deaver, the deputy chief of staff who I mentioned, and Edwin Meese, counselor to the president, the most ideological of the three. But William Clark, who was one of the president's national security advisors, would later say in an oral history that I read, the real Troika was Baker, Deaver, and Nancy. And she would, if she thought somebody wasn't serving the president very well, she would do what she could to make sure that person disappeared. She is one of the reasons that Ronald Reagan went through a half dozen national security advisors.
So when they would go upstairs in the evening and that door was closed, it was just the two of them, if we were flies on the wall up there, what type of interaction do you think we would have witnessed during those presidential years? Was she telling him what to do? Was she advising him what to do? Was there pushback on his part?
I think in some ways she was constantly on his case, constantly on the case of those around him, you know, not to overschedule him, to sort of put him in situations where she knew how he could perform at his best. She knew he needed time to himself. She knew he needed solitude. So she would say that her first concern was his well-being. But yes, other than that, she wanted to see every speech. She would pore over the polls. And as James Baker told me, if you could convince the First Lady that something was in the president's best interest, you had a pretty good shot of getting the president on board too. And as Nancy would later say, does he ever tell me no? Sure, he tells me no, and I wait a while, and then I come back from another direction. And sometimes she would recruit other people to make the argument for her.
Well, it seems to me that Ronald Reagan loved being president of the United States, really enjoyed that role of a lifetime, if you will. Do you think Mrs. Reagan enjoyed being First Lady?
She certainly had one of the rockier tenures in the job. Ronald Reagan first runs for president in 1976, barely loses the Republican nomination to the sitting president, Gerald Ford. She really encourages him as he's deliberating whether to try this again in 1980. She is one of the main reasons he decides to go for it. She convinces him, this is your time. By 1984, she doesn't want him to run again. Mm. She's terrified for his physical safety. She's, believe it or not, given that he would ultimately win 49 states, she's worried about whether he can get reelected. But I do think starting around 1982, 83, she does begin to find her own way in the job. She has smarter public relations advice. She embraces the cause of fighting drugs among the young. And she just finally, she just becomes much, much more comfortable in the role.
Talking about being comfortable in a role, it takes a lot of self-confidence to do what she did with the secondhand clothes story. Tell us how that came about, and it's a very self-deprecating moment, but also extremely clever.
So as she's rounding the bend from 1981, this really terrible year, into 1982, her popularity is such that she realizes that if Ronald Reagan she's becoming a liability to her husband. If he's going to succeed, she's going to have to succeed. And so there was a fresh new controversy over the fact that she is discovered to have been borrowing designer clothes, really expensive outfits, thousands and thousands of dollars worth of clothes, and not returning them. So there's a big dinner in Washington every year called the Gridiron Dinner. It's a press dinner, a white tie dinner. It's an evening of skits, you know, lampooning people. And so it's very clear they're not gonna be able to resist going after this fresh controversy. So at the White House, her relatively new press secretary, Sheila Tate, discovers they're gonna do a parody of the song Secondhand Rose, the Fanny Bryce song, and they're gonna call it Secondhand Clothes, and they're gonna have an actress singing all about Nancy Reagan and her secondhand clothes. And they go to the Gridiron Club and they said, she'd like to give a response, which surprises and delights the club. And so she keeps it a secret, but the song finishes. Nancy Reagan disappears from the head table at the dinner. This is a dinner, you know, most of the Supreme Court is there, ambassadors, and everybody said, oh, she must have been mad at that song. And the next thing people see is that this tiny woman appears on stage in the tackiest outfit you've ever seen, a big feathered hat and a feather boa and a flowered skirt and rain boots. And then they suddenly realize this is Nancy Reagan. And she sings a parodied version of secondhand clothes. And I think the final line of it is something like, I sure hope Ed me sews. And she's kept this a secret even from her husband that she was going to do this. Mm. So, and the end of it is she picks up a plate that looks like her china and throws it on the ground. So this is a gigantic standing ovation, calls for an encore. She doesn't have an encore. So she just sings the whole thing over again. And this time when she throws down the plate, it smashes, which then, of course, everybody loves. And it really does begin to change her image. And her husband gets up to give his speech at the same dinner. And he said, well, I arrived here a happy husband, and I'm going to be leaving a stage door Johnny.
That reminds me of President Kennedy's reference to being the man who accompanied Jackie Kennedy to Paris. Jackie Kennedy kind of stole the limelight in Paris, and Mrs. Reagan certainly did that night.
And the idea that this woman had a sense of humor at all, much less an ability for self-deprecation, was really quite a shock.
And there's a wonderful picture of President Reagan himself just guffawing at the dais, at the head table that night with her doing that. But fashion was a mainstay with her. She wanted to look her best, and she dressed her best. And fast forward to the time of the First Lady's portrait, which was done by Aaron Schickler, the same portrait artist, ironically, that did Jacqueline Kennedy.
You say ironically, I would say probably deliberately, but go ahead.
You're right. Okay, good point. You win that one. She's wearing that Galanos gown of the red, her signature red. Anything about the imagery of that and the similarity between those two portraits that strikes you?
It's the serenity in both of them. And I think the serenity in Nancy Reagan's case that was really sort of at odds with the reality of her life, but it's just both of them such beautiful, beautiful portraits.
The two most meaningful books that I have read this year are Peter Baker and Susan Glasser's book on James Baker and your book on Nancy Reagan. Yet these both focus on a presidency 30 years ago. What is it about the Reagans, President Reagan, Nancy Reagan, that still intrigues and captivates interest today?
Well, you know, it was the whole unlikelihood of his story, that, you know, this man could come out of Hollywood and really seize, you know, that he'd be elected governor, but also that he would dominate politics in not only his era, but, you know, for a generation to come. Mm. The idea, imagine any political candidate today who could win 49 states.
True.
And certainly his policies, there are a lot of people who will draw a straight line from Reagan-era policies to a lot of the, you know, less attractive themes in our politics today. But where I think the analogies fall apart is that Ronald Reagan's gift, I believe, was his ability to make the country believe in itself. Mm. Just the kind of sheer optimism that he was able to convey. And again, it just, to me at least, feels so at odds with everything about our politics today.
Mm. That's true, very interesting. Modern first ladies take on a cause or a purpose or a mission. Mrs. Reagan's, as you mentioned, was the crusade against drugs, and the three words, just say no, still bring her to mind today, all of these years later. How did she come to focus on that as an issue? How meaningful and real was it at the time? Did it play well with the administration and the press at the time?
People sort of love to roll their eyes at just say no today because it sounds very simplistic. And certainly, you know, people even in the time would see that as just sort of family friendly. Basically, her message, which was aimed at young children, elementary school children, just say no, was essentially designed to kind of change their perceptions of drugs and the acceptability of drugs. So it sounds very simplistic, and critics would point out that the Reagan administration was cutting funds for treatment and prevention programs at the time, that they were treating drug abuse not as a health issue, but as a law enforcement issue, and incarcerating a lot of people, including a lot of men of color. But I've actually taken a look at some of the research that was going on. And there's something called the Monitoring the Future Project, which is the single best longitudinal survey of attitudes towards drugs. And you really do see a shift from the 1970s into the 1980s, where children would go from saying, it isn't a big deal if my friend smoked marijuana, to, that's really unacceptable. And then back in the 1990s, the attitudes, once she's off the scene, once Just Say No is off the scene, the attitudes shift back. And another person I talked to was Joe Califano. No Democrat. This was LBJ's top domestic policy advisor, health secretary under Jimmy Carter. He now runs a center for substance abuse at Columbia University. He is a huge fan of Just Say No. In fact, at one point he had Nancy Reagan on his board. He said it was a simple message, but it was exactly what you wanted parents to be saying to their children. It's exactly what you wanted children to be saying to each other.
AIDS came on the world stage during the Reagan presidency. I had a great privilege of working for Admiral James Watkins, who chaired the Reagan AIDS Commission later when he was Secretary of Energy. But that commission was fraught with controversy, and Mrs. Reagan injected herself into that process. Why, and what were the results?
Well, before we even discuss AIDS, we have to stipulate that the Reagan administration's inaction on AIDS, its unwillingness to deal with it at all, really, until the second term, is a deep scar on its legacy and one that will never be erased. But I did find in my research for the book that, as belated as it was, Nancy Reagan became attuned to what was going on much sooner than her husband did, in part because her son was in New York in the arts world, dancing with the Joffrey Ballet. She was the daughter of a physician. She was making efforts to sort of get Ronald Reagan more in a sort of abstract frame of mind where he could look at this. It's ultimately the death of Rock Hudson, famous movie actor, that puts a face to it for Ronald Reagan. But when Reagan is finally ready, belatedly, to give his first big speech on AIDS in 1987, Nancy Reagan is not willing to entrust this to the right-wingers in the White House communications shop or the administration. She goes out, recruits her own speechwriter, Landon Parvin. She arranges for Ronald Reagan to actually meet for the first time with his own Surgeon General, Everett Koop, on the subject. The speech is not perfect, but I have seen the drafts and I have seen what people in the administration were trying to get the president to say, which is some pretty horrifying stuff looking back from 2021. And then finally, you're right, the commission is appointed to deal with it. It almost falls apart from mismanagement. When Admiral Watkins is brought in, it really does come out with an absolutely scathing and just on the mark report about the inaction and the mismanagement of the Reagan administration. One thing that Nancy Reagan insisted upon, it was quite controversial at the time, was that there be at least one openly gay expert on that commission. And you go back and read the stories, and people like Gary Bauer, who was a domestic policy advisor, or Gordon Humphrey, a conservative senator from New Hampshire, are saying, this should not be an administration that gives people appointments based on their bedroom habits. You know, that's the level of ignorance and bigotry that really still existed even as late as, you know, going into the late 1980s. Mm. Mm.
The Reagan years were somewhat glamorous years in Washington, D.C. It was Hollywood on the Potomac in many ways. President Reagan cherished and relished his Hollywood friends, and it seems that Mrs. Reagan did too. Any influence that she brought into the White House social dynamic that was particularly Hollywood-based from her years there?
She certainly brought in a big glamour factor. Frank Sinatra was a fixture at just about all sorts of events. And it was such a contrast from the Carter years. Jimmy Carter at one point banned the playing of Hail to the Chief because he thought it was too pretentious. So she not only brings back the glamour factor, she courts the liberal Georgetown scene where, you know, that essentially they had, you know, killed Richard Nixon with 1,000 snubs and slights. So she somehow manages to meld all of these worlds. And that really was Nancy Reagan's doing. I think Ronald Reagan really, you know, probably could have cared less who was sitting at whose table at which state dinner, or, you know, what the guest list was, or what the flowers looked like. She just stressed over every one of those details, and by the way, stressed out the kitchen staff and the people at the State Department as well over those details.
Well, I think she definitely got the importance of social diplomacy, and that when heads of state of other countries visit our country, they want to see the glitz and glamour of America, and certainly the Hollywood influence was part of that Mrs. Reagan introduced into that mix.
One of my favorite stories, by the way, on that, you read her memoir. The only member of the Reagan administration, as best I could tell, who escapes any criticism is George Shultz. She says, if George told me it was raining outside, I didn't have to look out the window.
Wow.
But she knew that George Shultz was quite a flirt. So she would always make sure that he was seated at the dinner next to the most attractive and glamorous actress there, and even George Shultz at the age of 97 just lit up when he told me, I even got to dance with Ginger Rogers. And when he does dance with Ginger Rogers, Nancy Reagan sends in a platoon of White House photographers and then sends Shultz enough photos of him dancing with Ginger Rogers to paper the walls of his office.
Well, you think about the power of those photos. There's the Diana and John Travolta picture, which is I saw this week on television.
And that's another thing. Travolta said it would never have occurred to him to ask the Princess of Wales to dance. And it's Nancy who comes up and nudges him. And he said, all of a sudden, I realized I was supposed to be Prince Charming that evening.
You mentioned Iran-Contra, a very significant moment in that presidency. Mrs. Reagan, did she get involved in many international affairs matters? What did world leaders think of her? Did they suspect that she had her thumb on the scale with President Reagan?
Certainly the Soviet leaders did. At one point, TASS, the Soviet news agency, was assigned a reporter to covering all the First Lady's events. But you mentioned Iran-Contra. That, to me, that chapter is the heart of my book. Because this is a scandal. It begins at the end of 1986, and it threatens to swallow the Reagan presidency. People who are too young to remember, it involved the United States was found to have been selling arms to this government's enemy, Iran, in exchange for the release of American hostages who were being held in the Middle East. And then the money from those sales was, in violation of U.S. law, going to the Contra rebels who were fighting the leftist Sandinista government in Nicaragua, all very complicated. When it breaks, Ronald Reagan, just, again, optimist, this is all going to work out, I didn't do anything wrong. It is really Nancy Reagan who believes this calls for a complete shakeup of the White House staff. starting with the chief of staff. Her husband doesn't want to do it. They go round and round and round about this for weeks. You know, he's like, I'm not going to sacrifice other people just to save my own hide. At one point, he is heard to scream at her, get off my back. Ultimately, she wins. The other thing she does, which is just as important, and I think maybe more important, was bringing Ronald Reagan around to the point where he could admit to the country and admit to himself that he had, in fact, in violation of all of his promises and all of his claims to the contrary, had traded arms for hostages. And in a televised speech, once again, Nancy doesn't trust the West Wing to write this. She brings in her own speechwriter. The president acknowledges this. It is compared to Kennedy's Bay of Pigs speech. The next day, his overnight poll ratings go up 9 points. Because a country that had begun to believe that Ronald Reagan wasn't being straight with them really gets its confidence back in his integrity.
That's an incredible behind-the-scenes story of her influence with him. But how did the White House staff react to that when she would pull the rug out from under them like that?
Okay. The smarter, shrewder people on the staff, the figures like George Shultz and James Baker, understood that she could be an absolutely crucial ally. She was somebody you wanted to have on your side. Mm-hmm. They were in the minority in the West Wing. She didn't set foot there very often, but if she was unhappy about something, they all knew it. And if somebody wasn't in her favor, they tended not to last for very long in their jobs. So you do see that, you know, a lot of the people around the president really thought she was just an annoyance.
Mikhail Gorbachev, Ronald Reagan on the world stage, the evil empire we talked about, eventually the fall of the Soviet Union. Two players just back from them, Arisa Gorbachev and Nancy Reagan. That relationship you talk about in your book, tell us that story.
Well, you know, for one thing, you would think these two women might have had a few things in common. Soviet first ladies before Raisa Gorbachev were real enigmas. Often the people in the country didn't know how many kids they had. Sometimes they didn't even know their first names. Raisa is a brilliant academic, her husband's closest advisor, outspoken in her own views. She too is criticized for being sort of aloof and too interested in fashion. She's seen sitting at the Pierre Cardin fashion show in Paris, not a place where you would normally find a Soviet. You wouldn't have found, you know, Nina Khrushchev there. But the two of them, she and Nancy Reagan, just the most delicious subplot of the three summits between Reagan and Gorbachev, four if you count Reykjavik, which wasn't supposed to be a summit. The most juicy subplot becomes these women sort of sniping at each other back and forth. Nancy gets tired of Raisa's constant lectures on the glories of Leninism. Raisa tours this White House that Nancy has redone and is so proud of, and she just says, well, it looks like a museum. I prefer a house that looks like a home. You know, so they are just really, each of them sort of like trying to figure out where the other's jugular is.
Well, let's keep with that theme. There's Nancy Reagan and another important woman in this scenario, and that's the Second Lady of the United States, Barbara Bush. And the relationship between Nancy Reagan as First Lady and Barbara Bush as Second Lady, then post-presidency when you have the former First Lady and Barbara Bush as First Lady, describe that for us.
They couldn't stand each other. Nancy Reagan wasn't that fond of the Bushes just in general. She ends up liking Bush 43. So the two of them, the general public didn't know about it at the time, but in Washington, it's not a very well-kept secret. And Barbara Bush, is pretty good at dishing it out as well as taking it.
She can hold her own.
Right.
Sure.
But you know, the fact that Nancy Reagan refuses to invite them to the Princess Diana, Prince Charles dinner, which is the most glittering social event of the entire Reagan presidency. And you know, her advisors keep going back, going, you know, Mrs. Reagan, we really should invite the vice president, don't you think? And no. But I think there's a number of factors. I would ask this question over and over and over again. And I think that for both of them, never really got past the bitterness of the 1980 Republican primary campaign. It was easier for the husbands to let go of this than the wives. And Barbara Bush certainly never let Nancy forget who she thought ought to be in the Oval Office rather than going to funerals of foreign leaders. But I also think there was a lot about Barbara Bush that triggered Nancy Reagan's insecurities. Even though Barbara Bush herself had a closet full of designer clothes, you know, she got glowing press coverage. She was America's grandmother. Everyone loved her. The Reagan family, and I write quite a bit about this in the book too, it was quite dysfunctional. And the Bush family is so close. And, you know, the kids are around, the grandkids are around. Barbara Bush can trace her ancestry back to the Mayflower. Nancy is always viewed as the, you know, parvenu from Hollywood, you know. So it's, like I said, there was, and it does continue even after the presidency. And one of the snubs is when Nancy Reagan was first lady and struggling, her social secretary, Muffy Brandon, goes back to her alma mater, Smith College, where Nancy actually graduated, and ask them if maybe they might want to give her an honorary degree or something nice for it. They won't do it. They said, her husband's too controversial. We might have demonstrations. Barbara Bush is a few years behind Nancy, but she drops out of Smith her freshman year to marry George H.W. Bush. Well, guess who gets an honorary degree?
Barbara Bush. Yes.
So then when Smith comes back to Nancy Reagan and says, hey, we've decided we want to honor you, she says, I don't think so.
Presidents savor their time away from the White House at a place. All of them have a place that they like to go. And for President Reagan, it was his ranch at Santa Barbara. Did Mrs. Reagan love the ranch as much as the president did, or did she love Ronald Reagan and put up with the ranch?
I think it was that. I mean, this was not a place that she would have chosen to spend her time. In fact, when they were there, she would usually spend most of her time by the pond, on the phone, with her friends. The other thing, but she knew Ronald Reagan needed this. She knew that this rejuvenated him. The other thing is that the Reagans used Camp David more than any other president before or since. And they would usually go with just a few aides so that they could just have the place pretty much themselves. The Secret Service would make a point of giving them 50 feet, you know. She did understand that her husband really needed this time to himself. And at one point, Richard Allen, the national security advisor, the first one, hears from Michael Devers and says, you need to quit loading the president down with these hundreds of pages of paperwork when he goes to Camp David on the weekend. And Allen goes, what do you mean? He reads it all. And Devers says, yeah, that's why. And sure enough, Nancy Reagan had issued this order, you know, cut down the paperwork by 75%.
Interesting. The chairman of our board of directors is Fred Ryan, also the publisher of the Washington Post, and the post-presidency chief of staff to President Reagan. And it was during that time that President Reagan came to grips with the Alzheimer's, and he wrote that extraordinarily poignant letter to the country. Tell us that story and Mrs. Reagan's role in that story.
Well, first of all, it is forever going to be probably debated as to precisely when the symptoms of Alzheimer's set in. And I lay out as clearly and dispassionately as I can in the book what I found to be the evidence. But it really becomes clear in the early 1990s. He begins to not recognize people he's known for decades, to become disoriented, as to where he is. And again, by the fall of 1994, the diagnosis is clear, and yes, he is going to, it is Reagan's idea to, that he should announce this to the country. He remembers that when he had colon cancer, when Nancy had breast cancer, that they had really done a great service to the country in bringing these diseases out of the shadows. And so he says, I want to write a statement. And he goes to the window, sits down at a table, writes this statement, and he hands it to Fred, and he says, now go get this typed up. Nancy reads it, her eyes fill with tears, and Fred Ryan says, we're not typing this up. We are putting this out in your handwriting so that people can see these are your thoughts. For Nancy Reagan, all of this, you know, she had thought, Ronald Reagan leaves office, a very hale, he's nearly 80, but he's by all appearances physically fit. Mm-hmm. All of a sudden, he's not going to have the decades that other presidents get to begin to write the first draft of their own legacies. So in addition to becoming the caretaker and guardian of his physical well-being, of his dignity for the last decade of his life, it really does fall on her to shape and define the legacy. Part of that is building the library. Mm-hmm. A part of it is defending him from people on the right who would appropriate Ronald Reagan's name and image for causes that he might not have supported. But there's also still this theory, particularly among liberal intellectuals, that Ronald Reagan was, in Clark Clifford's words, an amiable dunce. He was just an actor, you know, reading somebody, lines somebody else had written. And I think one of the most important things that she does in the last years of his life and beyond is to assure the publication of the diaries that he kept as president in his own hand, one of the few presidents who really did that, to the publication of his handwritten letters of half century, the publication of the handwritten speeches he had given in the years before the 80 election, so that people could see that these were Ronald Reagan's ideas, this was Ronald Reagan's governing philosophy, that, you know, really to assure that he would have a legacy that would not only establishment as him as what she wanted, you know, she wanted history to recognize him as a great man, but also to assure that this legacy is really true to who he was and what he believed. And ultimately, she also does something very, very controversial on her own. In the final months of her life, as George W. Bush is deliberating on what to do about one of the most promising areas of medical research, stem cell research, which involves the destruction of human embryos. And Nancy stands up publicly in 2004 at a very crucial moment in the debate over stem cell research and announces that she supports it. This causes an absolute explosion on the right. Somebody on Capitol Hill calls up Michael Deaver, her close advisor, and says, Ronald Reagan would never have supported this, to which Michael Deaver replies, Ronald Reagan hasn't had to take care of Ronald Reagan for the last 10 years.
That's powerful. And President Reagan passes, and there's an extraordinary funeral outpouring for him here in Washington and back in Southern California. And then Mrs. Reagan lives a number of years and participates in library events and carries on that torch a bit. But her time to pass comes, and her funeral is much different. It's all at the library. I had the privilege of escorting Mrs. Carter on that occasion and being there. Much different than the presidential funeral. Tell us about that sunset of Mrs. Reagan's life, that last public moment, and what that funeral said about her as a First Lady.
You know, her final years, as her husband is gone, her friends have disappeared one by one. She's suffering from a variety of health ailments, are very, very lonely ones.
Joanne Drake, who's one of the people who runs the library, people would call her and say, what can I do for Mrs. Reagan? And Joanne would always answer the exact same way, just call her. But you do see in this funeral where there are representatives of every presidential family going as far back as the Kennedys, where the tributes to Nancy Reagan are poignant and funny and incredibly honest about not just her strengths, but her flaws. And I think in that funeral, you really do begin to understand that it really isn't until the very end of her life, and especially after they see the stoicism with which and the devotion with which she dealt with her husband's final illness, that people begin to understand that for all of her complexity, for all of her flaws, for all of her demons, the real strength of her character. And I really think she was, you know, she paid the highest price imaginable for the acclaim that finally came her way.
You got to know Nancy Reagan pretty well in writing this book. What do you think she would think about it?
I would hope that she would think it was honest. I really tried to put everything in as much context as I could get. This book is no Valentine. This book does not gloss over the pain of her life. It does not gloss over her misjudgments, the many problems that she brought upon herself. But ultimately, I do think that when it came to picking a partner, Ronald Reagan did pretty well. And I think that she was just way, way overdue for a reassessment.
Thank you very much. This was extraordinary, but I need to end with one thing that is a little self-serving to the White House Historical Association. It's not prominent in your book, but in 1981, Nancy Reagan authorized the beginning of our annual White House Christmas ornament program. So for the past 40 years, the association has created these ornaments, each one telling a president's story, starting with George Washington, and this year is LBJ. We've stopped a few years along the way for key White House moments. These are made by a veteran-founded small business in Rhode Island, all American-made. And this year's the LBJ ornament, and it features the painting that Mrs. Johnson commissioned of the Blue Room Christmas tree. So we are very grateful to Mrs. Reagan for having this ingenious idea. I often joke if I'd been in the room with her in 1981 and somebody came in and said, let's make a Christmas ornament, I would have thought, sure, fine, whatever. But thank goodness they did, because for many, many years, this became the bread and butter of our work that allowed us to maintain the museum standard of the White House that Mrs. Kennedy envisioned. So in closing, it's probably not exactly socially proper, but I'll raise a toast in this official Reagan China to you, and congratulations on a wonderful book, and thank you for your time here this afternoon.
Thank you so much. It's been my honor.
Thank you.